And so what you do is you take a hold of those things that you can, the things that you get illumination or revelation on, praise God, start doing it. Those things that you just, you know, you hear but you don't know what they mean, do it. Hallelujah. And so in either case, you're going to end up doing something. Hallelujah. Because people want these things to work without, you know, participating. They want a lightning bolt come out of heaven, strike them down the center of their, you know, head or whatever, and then, you know, it's all going to work from there. But that's not how it goes. That's not the way it works. So I want you to open up your Bibles. I want you to look at two verses of Scripture with me tonight so that you can understand where we're going. And then you can understand, I want to help you with the roadblocks, because you run into roadblocks. I want to help you with the roadblocks. I want to help you to get into spirit knowledge and understanding, okay? Because if you have spirit knowledge and spiritual understanding, which is very similar to spirit of wisdom and revelation, then you're going to know how to move with God. And we understand that fundamentally that spirit revelation is everything beyond what you believe that you can do, and it's everything beyond what in the natural realm that you could do. And the example is Peter walking on the water. He saw Jesus walking on the water, and he understood the authority of it. Jesus, the living word, speaking his word, which would be, you know, in this particular instance, not the written word, just his word, saying, come, you know. And the Lord Jesus wasn't upset at Peter because he came. He's like, what's wrong with you, man? Why'd you start doubting? So if I can help you understand that spirit knowledge gets you out of the doubt realm, because spirit knowledge gets you out of being moved by circumstances, situations. This first thing that you got to understand how to do. Many people see the problems, they see the issues, and they try to go and fix them. Wrong. That now works counter to you walking on the water. That works counter to you moving in the giftings of the Spirit. You have to understand that there is two realms. There's the realm of the self, which can do nothing, and there's a realm of divine power. We can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. Of ourself, we can do nothing. Through Christ Jesus, we can do all things. That we have resident in our life, power. God will do all these things that we talk about, the fullness of Father's manifestation in our life according to the power that is at work on the inside of us. And now, he's not just going to do kind of stuff. Little stuff, maybe stuff. Some stuff, marginal stuff, you know, above average stuff. Super abundantly above. Okay? Everything that you've imagined. Have you imagined yourself walking underwater? I have. Have you imagined yourself being translated? I have. People don't believe in translation. You're never going to get it. People that don't pray for it, don't ask for it, aren't moving in that direction, you're not going to have it. You're not praying for it, believing for it, pressing in for raising the dead because you still think that you're a dead head. You know what? That's just really the satanic hindrance that stops you because you're not a dead head. I mean, God lives on the inside of you. It's just that you got to understand your frustration is the realm of self. And I want to help you demarcate between the two things, because what happens is that it's really easy to function, flow, and operation in the gifts of the Spirit. It's just that you get stuck in the self, and it's just, oh, mess. Oh, poor you. Poor me. Poor anyone. That's painful. You're just going to go, well, I can't figure my way out. No, you can't. So you're going to have to hear His Word. You're going to have hear His Word, hear His Word, hear it, and go, wow, I can do this. You know, we have people right now in this ministry, some that are, you know, younger in their 20s, some that are older, that receive very accurate visions, very accurate dreams, have very accurate words of knowledge to describe things that are going to happen around us, things that God's going to do in the ministry, outside here, things that happen here, things that are going on right here. And We don't display it. We don't talk about it because we don't need to. I don't need to say come up here so-and-so and tell what. Because this is for our information. It isn't a show-off, brag. Just we get to know what's going on. And so what I'm trying to say is that company of the anointing resides here. It's here. It's here. Yeah. Hallelujah. I was in a church not too long ago, and they really didn't have much of a display of the gifts of the Spirit. And yet it was a Pentecostal church. And I just told him, I said, this is the church. This is the church. I can tell you, I walked into the building. I can tell you, this is the church. Now, I want you to understand that resident in this church right now are all the gifts that you read about in 2 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 7 through 11. You just don't know how to access them. That's all. I'm going to say this. All the gifts of the Spirit are resident right here in the church. They're here. We demonstrate those gifts of the Spirit to you. And, you know, when we, and Spirit knowledge is so important to function in these gifts. Spirit knowledge is the knowledge of the holy. And God tells us how to go into the knowledge of the holy. Spirit knowledge is the knowledge of God. Spirit knowledge is that knowledge that comes to us by the new birth and by communication with the Holy Spirit and by the Word of God, primarily by the Word of God, but it's the Holy Spirit that unveils it and reveals it. Now, what's going to stop you is you doing your own stuff, period. And God hasn't withheld it from you. It's not that it's so hard and difficult you got to spend, you know, 40 years. But if you did need to spend 40 years and you spend 40 years staring at the glory to then do in what Joshua did in 1 year, look at all the exploits of Joshua in 1 year. He changed the world. He changed the context of the world. Somebody say you got to stay around God 40 years and then you get to do this. Well, people stayed around 40 years and then didn't do nothing after 40 years. Didn't hardly do anything in the 40 years and didn't do nothing after the 40 years. So it's got to be in the context of his glory. It's got to be in the context of touching the realms of the anointing. And what I'm talking to you about here tonight is I'm talking to you about something that you can have because you know how to flow and function and move in the Holy Ghost. You're not going to know how to flow and function and move in the Holy Ghost any more than you participated with. That's it. That's all. Now what you say, wait a minute. Well, I want more information because that just seems too easy. It's just too abbreviated. No, God touched you at one time. I believe everybody in this place has the ability to function in a realm, a supernatural realm that so many people can't even break through to at all, called the language of the Spirit. But at the same time, many of you have not understood how to give yourself to that realm to where that faith is produced in that realm and you excel. Part of it is you haven't known how to start doing the works of Jesus because you can't have this unless you do the works of Jesus. And you can't have these things. I mean, it really is just risk-taking. You've got to get out there in a place where you are proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ on a level that, you know, somebody's gonna get upset at you about it. And you're really going after signs, wonders, and miracles. And, you know, you're willing to roll with the disappointments and the discouragements and what appears to be failure. It's actually success just to obey God and you know, grab somebody's ears. I prayed for a person one night, kind of took me by surprise. I was with Carlos Anacondia, and they brought me this guy. They said, hey, we got to pray for this guy who's deaf. I said, bring him, you know. And they brought me this guy, and he didn't even have ears. Not only did not even have ears, he didn't even have holes. So that was a whole other level, okay? I need to work with that a little bit because I was, first and foremost, I was shocked. Whoa, okay. Well, I want spirit knowledge. Spirit knowledge is going to allow me to see the unseen. Hallelujah. But you're going to have to be able to participate with that when you read the Bible to where all of a sudden God begins to make visible to you what the Word of God describes that you can't see before you. So here's what you look at. There in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 31. I want you to look at that. I want you to understand, God wants us, hallelujah, to covet. Look at that. Can you read that? Is everybody there? I want to make sure you're there because I don't want to lose anybody here tonight. Praise God. Hallelujah. I want you to just do this. I want you to just do it. Hallelujah. 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 This is how everybody who ever moves in gifts did it. Here's how it works. Are you looking at it?
Yeah.
See the word covet?
Yeah.
Anybody see that word?
Yeah.
Okay. Covet. Huh? Anybody grow up playing competitive sports? Raise your hand. Competitive sports. Huh? And you were just so content not to be involved. Right? You're just so content. I'm just here to look. You know, I don't put me out there because I can't do anything. You wouldn't even be on the, you wouldn't even be playing competitive sports. You would have never showed up. Right? You showed up with skills that were so blown out of proportion in your own mind. You with me? Are you with me? You showed up so much better than you really were. All right? Okay. And that brought a lot of confidence. It's called covet. That's called covet. Are you listening to me? I got to have that as another dimension of covet. I want to do it, and I got to have it. Okay? You gonna, I'm going to tell you right now, you ain't going to be no 2, 3, 4, 5 years waiting to have something like that. You're going to stand up and open your mouth and do something. Huh? Hallelujah. Give me that glove. Give me that bat. I'll do something with it or whatever, you know. Hallelujah. So, who time I say hakitana maya? Hallelujah. Now, that is a part of it. And then another part of it, so you got this covet. You got this passion. I got to do it. I got to have it. It's mine. I got to have it. I got to do it. I got to do it now. Now, the longer you wait, the harder it is for you. Because the longer you wait, the deeper you get in the ditch called doubt. And it's vertical down there at the bottom, and it's V-shaped, and you can't get out. You have to have another miracle to get you out of that. Okay, so the longer you hesitate, the longer you wait, the less possibility. I'm going to scare you a little bit, okay? You just fossilize. And it takes a miracle. See, now you got to believe God for a miracle for just having the born-again faith. I mean, it's not to say that you're not born again. It's just that you sit around in doubt and unbelief so long. You know, because these things work in a realm of faith, which is way, way beyond confidence. Amen. It goes, it's so far beyond confidence and certainty that it's as far as the stars are from the ground, from the earth. That's how far faith is from confidence. I mean, people don't even have confidence. Well, you know what? You're just in doubt and unbelief. So how is it that I'm going to begin to move in faith? I'm going to begin to move in faith because I hear the word of God. God's called me to do it. And I want to do it. I want to, you know, I'm so excited. That's why I get all excited. I can, right now, I can read the New Testament. I get overwhelmed excited because it's my hair stands up on the back of my neck. I've read the stories hundreds and hundreds of times, but because they're real to me. See, you get hungry for these things. You start coveting. You start reading books like this, Unlimited Authority of God. And what it does is you read it again and you read it again. You go, my goodness gracious. I could do this? Really? I could do this? And then you want it. You want to have it. And you can't live without it. So the first part of that is coveting. The second part of it there is in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 1, being zealous. Huh? To be zealous. To be full of zeal to it for spiritual gifts. I was full of zeal for spiritual gifts. When I first spandoreste baya, I prophesied. I was zealous. Huh? I said, thus saith the Lord, listen to me right now, you know, and I just let it go. Huh? How much prophecy was it? But, you know, it was, God was blessing it. How much accurate prophecy? There was nothing harmful. I was zealous. I'm not going to stop. I mean, tongue of boasticatia, prophesy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the same way with interpretation tongues, people just sit around in doubt. They sit around in self. See, when you begin to do the Word of God, you have to step beyond the realms of self. You have to step around beyond the realms of restriction, beyond the realms of fear, beyond the realms of uncertainty, beyond the realms of hesitation, beyond the realms of I don't think I can do it, beyond the realms of all that stuff that you are well conditioned to do as you are getting yourself your little education to make you so whatever. You know what I'm saying? So distant from being able to cooperate with God. It doesn't necessarily have to be that way. It wasn't that way with Daniel. Huh? You know, Nebuchadnezzar went out there and he got the best. He didn't get the worst. He got the best. He cherry-picked all the best out of all of the nations. But when he got the best out of Israel, he got people anointed of the Holy Ghost. He got Meshach, Reshach, and Abednego. You know, he got Daniel. And look at how they're moving and functioning in the things of the Spirit. Huh? They were just bold. You know, this is bold. Tell me whatever your dream is. I've got the interpretation. Come on. Now, it's one thing to do that. It's one thing to do that just offline, and you've not allowed God to develop you, and you're not giving yourself over to the things of the Spirit. You're not hungry and thirsty for the things of the kingdom of God to be expressed to your life. And then it's another thing to be over, just the opposite, opposite of that. You give yourself the flow of the Spirit. You're so hungry and so thirsty and so passionate for the things of the kingdom. When God tells you in the Word, seek first the things of the kingdom, what's the first thing you think of? When you think of seeking first the things of the kingdom, most people think, well, I'm going to go to church. But when you talk about seeking first the things of the kingdom, he's talking to us about the display of heaven, display of the power of God. He's talking about the display of the power of God. He wants you and I to have the display of the power of God in our life. Hello. You know, if you could just get that the whole realms of the anointing anyways is to display the life and power of Jesus. That is what Father has ordained. So how many people, I mean, I look at people around. I've watched you guys. I mean, I watch people around. You know, how many people are stuck? You don't know how to step in to display the life of God. You don't know how to display the life of God. God told you, you got the life of God on the inside of you, on a level to where it comes out of you with expressions of rivers, and you're stuck. Why? Self. You know, there's such a stark contrast, and I hope that you can begin to deal with it more effectively, but you're not without spirit knowledge and spiritual understanding. You're not going to see it. It's going to be elusive to you. The line is not going to be plainly drawn. It's going to be, and there's just going to be this huge overlap. Because a lot of times what you've done is, what people do is they have so given themselves to self-dependency. That's the way they process. That's the way they think. That's their value system. That's what's important to them. Somebody says to me, how can you not respond to this thing or that thing? It's not important to me. It's meaningless to me. I have no value in it. I have no value in what's bad. Somebody says something bad to me, it's no value to me. It means it's nothing. It's meaningless. Because there's something, my affections are in another value system. What somebody thinks about me is meaningless. I'm in a totally another value system. No, what Father thinks about me, that's a big deal to me. Huh? Whether or not I can experience a manifest presence of God, that's a big deal to me. I mean, I'm one intensely upset, hurt person if I don't experience the presence, manifest glory of God. But look at what I'm doing. I'm not sitting around, you know, doing my own thing all day. I'm involved in the kingdom. I'm about the kingdom. I'm about everywhere I go manifesting the power of God, and not by anything that I can do. I'm relying upon supernatural power to do it. Now, because people, they run around, they want to go tell people about Jesus, and they're going to talk about the weather and chew, you know, every one of their words before it comes out. It's just all self. It's a self realm, and it's not going to profit you anything. Yeah. But the Lord says if you give all attendance to making your calling and election sure, he says he's going to do something.
Yeah.
He's going to open up for you an ability to function in another realm. Yeah. This is verse 11 of 2 Peter chapter 1. He says he will minister to you an entrance abundantly. He will reveal and cause you to understand, this is spirit knowledge, and cause you to know how to step over into an eternal, everlasting realm. He will minister an entrance abundantly to you into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're not talking about dying and going to heaven here. Okay, that's not even the context. We know we've already been translated from the kingdom, delivered from this world, and translated in the kingdom of your Son. He is talking to us about participating with him, recognizing that his divine power is here given to us because he wants us to function in glory, hallelujah, in his glory, hallelujah. And he's put a treasure on the inside of us so that the excellency of the power and the glory may be of him and not of self. Hard thing to do. Hardest thing to do. Self is the realm of your fears. Self is the realm of stubbornness. Self is the realms of disappointment. Self is the realm of where God directs you to do something and you want to go do something else. Self is the realm that shuts everything down that has to do with God. And you've just got to learn to not want it. You've got to learn how fundamentally to deny it. And one of the things that I believe helps more than anything else is rather than focus on denying the self, you're just so covetous and zealous about the things of the Spirit. You're so into the things of the realms of the Holy Ghost. Now, that is bigger to you than anything else. Now, you're not limited by self. Self takes such a back seat. It's a dynamic that I know that all the preaching and all the teaching and all the scripture that you're reading, that you do, isn't really going to make the difference of whether you walk in the realms of self or whether you walk in the realms of God.
Yeah.
It isn't. What you have to do is you've got to get hungry enough to where that you get spirit knowledge. That you get filled with spiritual wisdom and understanding. Hallelujah. In the knowledge of God.
Yeah.
And so, is the hardest part of functioning gifts of spirit. So if you've got that, it's all downhill from here. You stepped in. You're the hardest part. Done. Miracles, signs, wonders, word of knowledge, discerning of spirits. All of those things now are going to grow and mature in your life as you give yourself to those realms. And, you know, if you're just doing this at home with your teddy bears, okay? If you're laying hands on fictitious things, you're not going to develop in this. If you're walking up to someone, if you're walking down the street and all that's going on in your heart is, oh God, please, Father, use me to bring somebody into the kingdom. Oh Lord, cause me to have your compassion. Cause me to understand how to move with you. And your concern and your care is for where Father's care and concern is. And you're saying, I'm praying for a divine appointment. Oh God, give me a divine appointment. And Lord, I just thank you for giving me a word of knowledge. Give me a word of wisdom. Show me, Lord, how to touch this person's heart, how to unlock their heart. And then all of a sudden, you know, you'll have that event. You just pray that event in. You just prayed the event in. Huh?
Yeah.
And then you begin to minister to them, begin to talk to them, and the anointing of the Holy Ghost is there, ready for you to move in, but he's standing there waiting for yourself to shut down because you're afraid.
Yeah.
You want to talk to them, hi, how are you? My name is, where are you from? Because you're afraid.
Yeah.
You don't know how to move. You don't know how to move the Spirit. Yeah. You don't know how to walk up to them and begin to display to them those things that are on the heart of Father for them. Here's the good thing, though. The more you do it, the better you get at it. The more you mature, you grow. You get strengthened in it. Hallelujah. You get courageous in it. You get bold in it. You get confident in it. And really, what is so central to moving in the realms of the gift of faith, because fundamental to all of this really is, I mean, if I wanted to, almost like if I did the hub for the gifts of the Spirit, it would be the gift of faith. Okay? But the gift of faith is powered by and functioned by and exists by this love of God. And this love of God produces within us this amazing compassion. Amazing compassion that brings us into such servitude, we almost lose all self-consciousness because we don't have any self-need. We begin to move away from self-need and self-awareness. And so you can see how the world, see how the church is stuck? Because the church is really all about, in the Western world, self-consciousness, self-need, my stuff, I can't believe somebody said that about me, all the stuff that belongs to strife, envy, division, wherever demonic thing is at work, that's going to work opposite. That will absolutely bolster your self-interest and amplify your self-need. Can you hear me? I want you to be able tonight, I want you to be able to grab a hold of something tonight where you can begin to start dealing things out of confidence and out of certainty instead of out of frustration. One of the things that you're going to begin to do is Father shows us two hands for beginners. You're going to begin to give thanks. You'll be thankful and happy about everything. And you just leave it to the Lord. You trust him. You know that he's going to empower you. You just begin to gain this great confidence in God. Hallelujah. You don't go to bed at night without saying, Lord, I want you to speak to me in my dreams. So, you know, I want to see angels, Lord. I want to see you. It becomes a passion. Because, you know, there's some people that's got that all the time. There's other people who hadn't thought about that for a couple years. Oh, yeah, I remember one time I wanted to see an angel. Well, you're not desiring this interaction with the Spirit, the spiritual. See, because 1 Corinthians chapter 14 doesn't say spiritual gifts. It says the spiritual. It's the unseen realm. You're just willing to go, oh, whatever, you know, and I want to do whatever I can do. I don't know what I'm going to do, but I want to do whatever. What do you want to do with your life? Oh, I don't know. I just want to be flexible and, you know, be available to God and whatever he wants. You're not going to ever do nothing.
Yeah.
You'll never do nothing. Whatever he wants. Give me a break.
Come
He's made known what he wants. And if you're not going to start moving in what he wants, you know, you're never going to have anything. That is just the biggest doubt and unbelief statement there is on the planet. That's a cop-out statement. It really is totally a cop-out statement. Huh? Go in any institution, college, institution, workplace, and if they tell you, then they're interviewing you, what do you want to do? Oh, I don't know. I'm just available, whatever. You know, I'll just do anything. I don't, you know, just want to be used by you. They're just going to say, well, you know, please thank you for coming in, and we're glad that you gave us a resume. We got it here. You know, we got a couple of other more interviews. And as soon as you walk out the door, in the trash. But yet we do that with the Lord if we're not careful. We become overwhelmed. You know the overwhelming feeling? Self. And Satan will, by and large, anything that Satan could communicate to us, really about the only way he can do is to communicate it to us through the self realm. It's not an evil realm. That's why I move away from the word flesh. I know what most people use when they use flesh, but I'm just concerned they're not. I just want to make sure they're not saying that there's something evil in them when they say flesh. Oh, it's my flesh. Okay, well, what do you mean it's your flesh? You mean that's just your propensity towards evil? Well, then that's wrong because you're already compromised. You're not going to go very far. Okay, I want you to say it's yourself because Jesus had a self and there was nothing unholy about that self. He just said, I don't do anything by it. Now watch how Satan's going to try to access him. You need to eat. He's going to say, you need to eat. If you're the Son of God, turn the stone into bread. You need to eat. What is he trying to do? He's trying to access what he can do in Christ Jesus' life through the realms of the self, his own self-interest. He says, you know, bow down to me and worship me, and I'll give you all the world. I'll give you everything. Okay? And then, you know, so riches, self-interest. And he says to him, he said, and then he's going to work on identity. He's going to work on, okay, he's going to try to go after, you know, the self-interest that says you need to support your claim. If you're really the Son of God, huh? Cast yourself down from this temple because the scripture says, see, who knows the scripture? Huh? Who knows the scripture? The devil knows the scripture because the scripture says he'll bear you up in his hands. The devil knows the scripture far better than Christians most instances. Huh? So he'll just twist it, turn it around, and people listen to all these things that come out of the realm that is here called the spiritual world, and it has an influence. And if you do not know how to actively stand out against it, it's influencing the way you think. So you can't function in the knowledge of God. So that's why 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and chapter 10, verse 4, said that you got to shut down the imagination. So then you get somebody in your life like me, and I look at you and I tell you what your problem is, and you get upset. Self-realm.
Yeah.
He's picking on me.
Yeah.
Yeah, we are picking on you. We're trying to help you quit being so full of yourself.
Come on. Yeah.
We're trying to help you come over into being something that is a value in the kingdom.
Yeah.
We're trying to point out to you, this is why you haven't moved forward in X many years. This is why you look and act and think the same way you've been looking and acting and thinking. This is why you haven't won a soul into the kingdom in however many months or years or whatever. But see, the Lord said if we'll do certain things, he will then make, it will result in us not being unfruitful. That rather we'll be fruitful. It will do these things. We will not be unfruitful in the knowledge of God. Spirit knowledge. Hallelujah. Spirit knowledge will produce within our life supernatural results. Spirit knowledge isn't going to happen in our life unless we'll go with the Word of God and the things of the Spirit of God, go wide open with them, and then take and pay attention to the spiritual instructors that God has brought around us and learn how to be accountable. People, I'm telling you right now, I got grown men, preachers done far more than I've ever done saying, look, I want you to pastor me. I want to be accountable because they get it.
Yeah.
And then we get people sitting in the church and done nothing, save 6 months, and they don't want nobody over them. You listening to me?
Yeah.
That is endemic to the disease state of the church. It's called rebellion. And it functions through a self-realm. It's a high-mindedness. It's pride. Spirit of pride. It's high-mindedness. You don't need any structure. Huh? Come on now, Bebo, I'm trying to talk to you. I want to help you with the knowledge of God. You've got to learn how to do this because the best thing to do, you know what? When you wanted to ride a bike, how intimidated were you? Think about it. I got on that thing and wrecked. I got right back on it. I wrecked again. Third time, I'm gone. And I've been riding ever since. Well, I wasn't going to let nothing stop me. How about you? I mean, come on. My goodness gracious. Because when Father begins to show us these things, when we begin to take a hold of spirit knowledge, he says, no, no, no. Look how you went after that. Why haven't you been contemplating and evaluating? One day the Spirit of the Lord told me, he said, that if the world had participated in the realms of the knowledge that they had, the way that the church has participated within the realms of the knowledge of God, we would still be in covered wagons and mules. We just covered wagons and mules. At best. I'm not talking about the old ones. I'm talking ones back the ones 2,000 years ago, 3,000 years ago. Not the modernized ones of 1800s. We have too little contemplated, we've too little grabbed hold and investigated these things that Father has made available to us. Then we would understand, wait a minute, I have got to touch this realm of divine glory. There's people that sit around and I would say, supposedly, and maybe even it's real, they and wonder where God is. That is a miracle realm. I can't help but that you turned it into something less. I can't tell but you turned it into a religious exercise because you never hooked up with the faith. In fact, you opted out of having an instructor that come and say, tell me where I'm missing it at here. Let me be accountable to you in this, huh? You know? Yeah, I mean, come on. I mean, think about it. How many times have you tried to raise someone from the dead? Every one of you called in here, how many times you tried to raise somebody from the dead? That you've gone in and you've laid it out, you've gone after it, not 30 minutes. You went after it, fasting and praying to raise somebody from the dead. How many times? You're supposed to be doing it. That's what we're called to do. I was in not too long ago in a place, and the pastor got a word, said, well, one of his parishioners died. I said, well, the Lord told us to go raise him from the dead. If you want me to go, I'll go pray for them, raise him from the dead. And they're just looking at me like some of you are looking at me right now. And it's a Pentecostal church because that's what our assignment is. We don't get it. But when we do start doing it and engaging in it, then the next thing this self-realm is going to have to deal with is a sense of inadequacy, failure. You can't weary in well-doing here. You just got to say, wait a minute, I've been obedient to God. I've stepped out. And then you don't just go, well, you know, it's all in the Lord's hand. No, then you go back home and you go, Father, I know I need to take hold of you. Just like what happened with you. You know, you got out there, you started ministering to people and recognized, man, this is nothing but S-E-L-F, right, with the capital letters. Underscored, highlighted. This is me, and me, and me, and me, and nothing else but me, and me, and me. Huh? A lot of you have never even come to that reality. That's a reality. That's spirit knowledge. Spirit knowledge had entrance into your life to give you a demarcation between that which is of self and that which is the spirit, because you got yourself out there. And you recognize, I'm not getting a supernatural result here. Hallelujah. And, you know, I mean, I've watched people step out and they're going to interpret people's dreams. That's fine. I mean, you know what? I am just excited about anybody that's going to be zealous because there's people sit around the church for 50 years and never even attempted to interpret anybody's dream. Huh? There's so many people, the things I start talking about, Joshua commanding the sun and moon to stand still, you know, rock, water, calling water out of the rock. They didn't even believe it happened, much less believe that they can do it now. But the Lord told us to do it now. He told us to do something bigger than calling water forth out of the rock. He told us to do something bigger in some respects than saying to the sun, or just as big, saying to the sun and moon stand still. He said to say to the mountain, be removed and cast into the sea. And he's telling us, how is this going to happen? It's going to happen in the realms of faith. What is faith? Spirit knowledge. How are we going to be trained in spirit knowledge? We got the Holy Ghost come and teach us, and he's given us apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. I wanted James to come tonight. I was going to let James, just have James do a part of this meeting tonight. He got up at 12 o'clock to go to the airport, 12 midnight yesterday, our time, 3 o'clock in the morning, his time, from Connecticut. And I was just going to have him just go ahead and do at least, 2-3 words of knowledge. Well, how did he step into that? He got so passionate. They just sat around fasting and praying day in, day out, day in, day out, day in, day out for the word of knowledge. And then they got to the place where it's like, okay, we're tired of sitting here. Now we've been praying. We've been believing God for it. Now let's just see what God will do. And then, we get one thing, yellow dress. Okay, let's go look for a yellow dress. They're on a mission. They go walking around town. There's a yellow dress. And now to see the yellow dress, the next thing is, what's the next word, And of course, he would tell it different or say it different. I'm just going to go with what would be an example of what they would do. And then see the yellow dress? Oh, her name's Jane. Hey, Jane, And because one step at a time. And now we get up to Jane. And now I know where she's at. I know where she came from. Oh, you're from. And you are. And this has been happening. Well, you starting to learn how to speak by the Spirit, but you taking some risk, aren't you? Yeah. You taking a risk that somebody's going to dial 911. Somebody completely insane's out here, messing with me or whatever. People don't want to do that. I do. I do because I'm covetous. I got to have it. I can't live without it. I've got to have that. That is mine, and I've got to have it. I've got to have one of them too. Huh? But if you've got to have one of them little cars and one of them little things and one of those little things that are purely earthly, it's working counter to the things that belong to the realms of the Spirit. You got to decide where your passions are and where your desires are. Because I want you to understand, this is fundamental to having it. I can't live without it. I've got to go on a word of knowledge search tomorrow. But what's going to happen? You say that. You say, I'm going to start stepping in. I want to function in the word of knowledge. One of the things have I messed up in the word of knowledge? Yes, I have. I have. Totally way off. Your name is Sally. No, it's not. way off. You're married. No, I'm single. Did it discourage me? No. Are we going to be challenged with things like that? Yes, but I tell you right now, I have gotten it right. I was with Pat the other night, and when the word of knowledge comes to Pat, he goes, "Mail has arrived! The mail just came in!" He gets kind of weird. The mail is here! What happens? And I'll give you an example. And this is zealous. This is being zealous. He's just like a little kid. And it's so accurate. It's so accurate. He's got this great history of accuracy, okay? And so he looks at this husband and this wife early on, the first night. He said, "I know there's a word for you. I know God's got a word for you. It's going to come, And then what was it? It was Saturday night, at the end of the meeting, we were going at it. I preached Saturday morning, I preached Saturday night, and then we, I got everybody up there, we're going after it. And so like about midway, an hour or so into the altar, he goes, "Mail has arrived! The mail is here." Beautiful. And he just lays it out there because of those people that he said. He talked to them and told them how many children they're going to have. Just went down the whole list. Here's what God's going to do with it. Walks up to one woman and says, "You know what you have written across the top of your head? I'm insulted and don't like people. Everywhere you go, you create all kinds of troubles and create all kinds of a mess. Why don't you just give it up tonight?" I'm thinking, you're kidding me. Somebody else gives words of knowledge that are so accurate and so to the point. Come on. But those are the big breakthroughs. People, sometimes the biggest moments of breakthrough is when you are challenged with the biggest you. This is you. This is you in living colors. Here it comes. This is going to insult you bad. This is going to break your worst fears right down in front of you, and then everybody's going to listen in to just how messed up it is. Yeah. Hallelujah. And then if you respond, I don't want that, I want God, man, I'm going to tell you right now, floods of heaven is going to come. And, you know, you don't want to get that ornery. That's a person that had just been ornery. They just been ornery. Of course, you know, I saw it all over the two when I first walked into the building. You know, for me, I can see the thing. I mean, I could smell it. I could be blindfolded, walk in the room and go, oh, there it is. It's right back over there. God gives us grace with the discerning of spirits to try to help people. Most people who need the most help do not want to be helped. You don't, can't help them. Why? Self has created a barrier between them and God. You don't want to be sensitive about you. You won't be sensitive about him. You want to learn how to be sensitive to the Holy Ghost, not sensitive to you. That's got to be challenged. That's got to be challenged. Your little sensitivity, my little sensitivity, has got to be challenged. And what's going to happen is you are more than likely going to hang on to yourself. It's going to be okay. No one really understands you like I do. You know, you live the rest of your life hugging yourself and missing out on heaven. You got to bend your will. You got to be willing to be broken. You got to be willing to be broken. You got to be willing to be a laughing stock if you want to participate with putting God on display before man. And you and I are called to put Christ Jesus on display before the world. Think about it. Hallelujah. I'm going to do it. I'm going after translation, man. I'm telling you, people think I'm just joking when I talk about being translated into Mecca, Saudi Arabia. I'm not joking. I'm not joking. I'm tired of flying. Hallelujah. I heard about a guy who pastored a church up in Siberia, and he was able to pastor two or three or four churches within a 1,000-mile range, and he was in every service on Sunday morning. He was being translated. Praise God. He didn't have a lot of these other influences saying you can't do that. Hallelujah. He's just out there in the woods, didn't know any better. God said so. We're going to go after it and do it. This is what needs to be done in the kingdom of God. I'm the only one to do it. There's no way possible for me to get there by any other means. I can't go by dog sled and be there 1,000 miles. Come on. What works against it, once again, is the knowledge of men. The knowledge of men is a self-realm knowledge. That's the imagination, the logizimos. You have to be willing to cast down imagination and bring every captivity, every thought into captivity to the knowledge of God. So every thought, I demand you to think in the realms of the knowledge of God. The knowledge of God is I can walk on the water. Hallelujah. I'm going to walk on the water. I'm going to multiply the loaves and the fishes. I'm going to tell you right now, I know for a fact. I know it for certain. I know it. I know it as certain as I know anything in God, that I had a moment in time where I was going to turn the water into wine. I was at a pastor's conference. I was doing the Assemblies of God pastor's conference in Papua New Guinea. And I told them, I said, bring water. Bring water. They said, we're going to do communion. We don't have grape juice. I said, that's no problem. Bring water. And I had the faith for it. I felt I was going to pray over that, have them pour it out. We were going to have grape juice. I mean, it's going to happen to me again. The gift of faith ultimately doesn't come to us out of an imagination of our mind. We've already dealt with that. You're going to have to grow and mature. You're going to have to deal with that. You're going to have to spend enough time in the Holy Ghost. You're going to have to spend enough time going after these things, doing these things. Otherwise, you'll never know the difference. Because what happens is most people live every day of their life in the imaginations of their mind. They've never had the contrast. They've never been up against it to have the contrast so that they can understand the difference between the imaginations of their mind and the knowledge of God, the information the Holy Ghost gives. They constantly live with whatever they're thinking. Oh, well, I think I should do this, or oh, I feel I should do this, or that happened, or this happened, or whatever. Forget about it. You're never going to do nothing. You've never allowed the spondylolisthenes membranae dikinindalabastarevetisatolo to be the one means by which you make decisions. Huh? You never shut down. You've never understood the weapons of your warfare to shut down that other thinking realm. And that, I mean, that's what the pressure is on you to have that other thinking realm. You've never just said, no, we're just going to trust Father here. We're just going to go with Father here. No, I'm not going to spend my opinion. No, if you're going to spend your opinion all the time, that's all you're ever going to have. You have to learn how to shut your mouth and no longer spend your opinion and no longer have your attitudes. Because Father wants to grow us and mature us in this realm. Because he wants to bring us to what? The obedience of Christ. What is the obedience of Christ? The obedience of Christ can be highlighted in John 5:19. I cannot do anything of myself. I don't do anything of myself. It's the Father that does the work. I'm relying on him. I'm hearing him. I'm going to hear what he has to say, and I want to do it. So, we have two dimensions here that we really want to focus on. We have the dimension, number one, of reaching the lost, okay? Number one. I mean, my goodness, people, you're going to have to understand that the fire of God has got to move in your life to such a place. Listen, if you've delayed, the barrier, the wall got thicker. The breakthrough barrier got thicker. So it's just going to be harder for you to break through. If you soon, as you give your life to the Lord, you just start doing this. Huh? You don't have a thin little layer of breakthrough to get into, okay? You know, just start doing it. And then expecting it's not that going to be you that speaks, but the Spirit of your Father that speaks. Whew. Now you're getting hooked up with the Spirit of the Father. Hallelujah. It's the Spirit of the Son. Hallelujah. You just start speaking, and all of you will come just the Word of God to them. Hallelujah. Praise God. Huh? It's this, the Holy Ghost speaking on the inside of you. And then that matures in every area of the vocal gifts, of the word of knowledge, of the word of wisdom. I'll just start speaking to people. I'll just, in a counseling room or when I'm on the airplane or wherever, and they'll turn to me and go, are you a mind reader? Because why? I'm just speaking to them right out of the stamona maki ala mashipeyata maola. I'm speaking to them, but I'm speaking to them with the words that's come from the same inspiration realm. And I'm just speaking. I'm not figuring out. I'm not under fear. I'm not under pressure. I'm not having to think about it. I'm just talking to them. I'm talking to them as natural as any other way you would talk to them. But I'm talking to them things about their soul and about what they need. What really, I'm bringing them to a point of making a decision about Jesus. And out of that, what goes on as I begin to declare by the Spirit the personal things of their heart and of their life. Now, that's what it grows into. But you know what? That didn't grow into that dimension because I sat around in my living room hoping one day to go talk to people about Jesus. And I didn't talk to people about the Jesus and about the things of the kingdom because I was under some kind of obligation or pressure to do it. Huh? I had a compassion that compelled me. You can't even start until you get a compassion that compels you. I got born again. When I was born again, I had a compassion that compelled me to go to the lost. Oh, it's because you were called into the ministry. Well, they didn't say that in the Bible. That's something that happened. Everybody, anyone, whosoever. It's just, this is what we're called to do. We're all called to be evangelists. And then the second area in which these gifts of the Spirit are to function is in the midst of the church. Hallelujah. And you know, let's think about this. When you look in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, it says that if all of you prophesy, right? One by one, then what's going to happen is the lost, the unbeliever comes in and the thoughts of his heart are revealed and he falls down and saying, right, surely God is in this place. Now let's think about how the thoughts of the heart are revealed. For the word of God is powerful and living and sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing asunder joint, soul from spirit, joint from marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. See? So it's really the ministry of the word that we're filled up with. Woo! And that's the springboard, you see? It's the springboard for the word of knowledge. Do you understand? It's a springboard for prophecy. Hallelujah. It's a springboard for the word of wisdom. See, the word of knowledge is only used one time, at most twice, at phrase in the Bible. The rest of the time it's the word, it's the knowledge of, it's God's knowledge or the knowledge of God. Okay? So I get filled up with the knowledge of God. I get filled up with the wisdom of God from the word. So I'm speaking to someone just out of the knowledge of God, just his written word. And guess what comes with that? All of a sudden, as I'm talking, I'm speaking out things that that the Holy Spirit has given me the same kind of inspiration about, you know, the same kind of inspiration as I'm being called by the Holy Ghost to speak a verse of Scripture, you know, and then by the Holy Spirit explaining that verse of Scripture right out of that same in-between context kind of thing, in-between sentences, something that's personal about that person comes out, huh? Something what they were already thinking about, but they was already pondering in their heart. A question that they had. I have people come to me all the time. One of the people, Geneva, come to me. She'll tell me, and this happens a lot, but I just use her. She'd come to me and she'd say, every time I ask the Lord any question, it's without fail. I'll come to the meeting. You'll answer it right the first part of the meeting. Just why? Do I know I'm answering the question that she just asked God? No, I'm speaking by inspiration. I'm speaking by the Spirit. How did I start speaking by the Spirit? Did I start speaking by the Spirit, talking about the weather and how Aunt so-and-so's doing and Grandma's doing and, you know, whatever. How the flowers look. By the way, have you ever heard? No, I'm speaking the word of God. Are you listening? I'm wanting to deliver something from heaven that is specific to the purposes of Father right now for his church. To hear what the Holy Ghost is saying to the church. To what? Exhort you. To comfort you. To build you up. To see you get strengthened. Now, out of that, hallelujah, comes the word of knowledge. So now that's the context of where it works in the church. Out of that comes this prophecy. Out of that comes this word of, hallelujah, of wisdom. Out of that, just go in here. I'm going to go into Revelation. I'm going to function in all nine gifts of the Spirit. Hallelujah. But outside, and sometimes certain gifts are going to be stronger than others. Sometimes I'm going to feel, you know, a stronger anointing of the gifts of healing. I can see the gift of healing. I can see it. I love being a, and I can't explain it. You got to get over there and handle it, huh? And I like trying to do it when somebody's around. Say, hey, that's it. I see that right now. It's happening right now. There it is. Just so that you can listen. You can hear what's going on. But if you're just all sleepy and not really interested, you're not going to see all this stuff that goes on between myself and Tim Hall when he's speaking, or myself and someone else who's speaking. You're not going to see this dynamic being played out. You're just offline. You're not zealous for the things of the Spirit. You're not covetous to learn. You got to understand, people, God wants you to pay attention to the things that are going on in the Spirit, that you may learn how to flow with the Holy Ghost and move with the Holy Ghost with greater interest and passion than you had about learning whatever your trade or vocation is. Or whatever else you're interested in. And it deserves a whole lot more attention. And when our passion is there, when our hunger is there, when we got to have these things, we're going to be sitting up in our chair paying attention. Now, what Satan does is he tries to lock people down in their self realm, feel bad about themselves. I wish I could do that. I don't know why I'm such a slow person. Or whatever, you know. And that's the whole thing, they're thinking, the whole meeting. What did you get out of the meeting? I'm slow. The power of God fell in a radical way. I watch this over and again, where the Spirit of the Lord will bring somebody to the point of confrontation. And all they've got to do is simply obey God. It's like the person who's there and they just don't feel like flowing in the Holy Ghost. They don't feel a flow. They don't feel the stuff. But they don't feel it. And so what they do is they just go with what they feel. That is nuts. That's just, you're governed by the self realm. You're just governed by self. Well, I don't feel it. Well, why don't you just go ahead and obey God and start praying in the Holy Ghost? Why don't you go ahead and obey God, start getting filled with the Spirit? Why? Because all of these things, once again, when we're talking about the gifts of the Spirit, when we're talking about the realms of the spiritual, every bit of this belongs to that which the Holy Ghost is going to teach us. And he's not going to teach us basically, as it were, in a classroom and doing just theory. Okay? He's going to teach us as we do it. It has to be, come over here, let me show you. I'm going to lay hands on the sick. Come over here, let me show you how to cast out this devil. Hallelujah. Ambrusate. You should have seen me first time I tried to cast out a devil. Man, I tell you right now, it was I had me one. It was a real one. And it wasn't going to listen to a single thing that I had to say. It was just hectic. It was terrible. I screamed. I hollered. I spit. I did everything I could possibly think of. I mean, you know, and nothing, there's nothing, no results. Well, I could have said, well, it's not for today, you know, don't have the goods or whatever. No, I just said, Lord, I want to learn. I want to grow. I want to mature. Huh? Give me another opt. I went out looking for another devil. We're going after this one again. I didn't just sit around and go, you know, well, you know, maybe the next 10 years I'll never have another opportunity. We're on the hunt.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
We miss that one, we're getting the next one.
Yeah.
Come on. What is that? Covetousness. I can't live without this. I got to have it. I'm seeking first the kingdom of God. I want these things that God's described about my life, in my life. I'm going to do this.
Yeah.
I dare a devil to show up.
Yeah.
I dare a devil to show up. I mean, the devil's going down. How is he going to go down? He's going to go down through the manifestation of the Holy Ghost through me.
Yeah.
Ooh. So then I've got to have the Holy... So if he's going to go down through the manifestation of the Holy Ghost through me, I've got to learn how to allow the Holy Spirit to operate in me and participate with him so there's a manifestation through me. And reality of it is, I get a picture of this. I get a quantitative, literal measurement of this. Are you with me? Because when I start praying, I can start praying right now, and I can get totally lost in the glory, okay? And I will literally feel the presence of the Lord come over my body, and impact and touch every one of my emotions and every one of my attitudes. And it could happen that I become hysterically laughing. It could happen that I'm just overwhelmed with love. It could happen that all of a sudden I begin to hear in my spirit specific things I've never heard before, I've never known before. A dramatic communication goes on. But here's a beautiful thing. You can feel that. Other people can feel it. And you have felt that. Because when there's a release of the anointing, okay? How many of you, it's like maybe you've sat in the meeting and you really didn't feel much of anything the whole meeting, but just as soon as I started to pray for somebody, the power of God fell on you. What was going on? I was participating with what God told me to do. Many times, I've had this happen many times. I'm walking towards a person who's responded for prayer, okay? And I didn't really feel anything. And yet there was still, because I was cooperating with God, there was a release of the anointing. Now, the more powerful release of the anointing is when the Lord gives me something. He says something directly to me, and I go to someone. And because I've now learned how to listen to him. Where did I learn how to listen to him? Communing with him, enjoying his presence. Hallelujah. I'm going to someone and I'm saying, I'm giving them a word of knowledge. This is what the Lord just told me. As soon as I do that, you'll feel a release of the anointing. Why? I'm cooperating with the Holy Spirit. Now, when are you going to do that? Some of you. I know many of you, and you're just doing it. You're already, some of you just aren't, you haven't done it. You just haven't done it. You think it's okay not to do it. It's not okay not to do it. It's not okay.
Yeah.
It's lukewarm.
Yeah.
It's just lukewarm.
Yeah.
And if you can be happy with being lukewarm, because I just don't really feel it's my calling. What Bible are you reading? Because we only have one calling. There's only one ministry. Well, I just don't feel qualified. Well, why don't you just go ahead and get qualified? Huh? Why don't you go ahead and get qualified now? Now that you feel unqualified, why don't you go ahead and get qualified? Now why don't you make heaven your interest? Because this cannot happen when heaven's not first to us. Jesus said, if I cast out devils by the Spirit, then the kingdom of God has come to you. The kingdom of God is being revealed. What kingdom are you seeking? Well, what does it mean? Everybody's sitting around religiously singing, seek ye first the kingdom of God. And they're telling each other. They're not telling themselves. They're telling each other to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. But when is it that we individually are going to say, I'm going to seek first, I'm going to make the kingdom first? What is the kingdom? Signs, wonders, miracles, demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. This is God's plan. So if it's God's plan, this is what he wants to do. Anybody who believes, this is what you're going to do. Anyone, you're going to do these works and greater works. And what is he going to do? He's going to prepare us unto every good work, to the greater works. Hallelujah. And what we got to do is we got to recognize, wait a minute, I can't have false models and false influences to be able to move over into these greater works, and I want to be prepared. But reality, if it is, I can't be prepared outside of experiencing and interacting with the manifest presence. Hallelujah. So somebody said, well, I just don't feel the manifest presence, and I'm tired. You lazy.
Yeah. True.
And you have other interests.
Yeah.
So stop that. Somebody says, well, after 9 o'clock, I'm just shut down. Well, make sure that you get into the things of the Spirit before you shut down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Now, what the Lord will bring you to is that where somebody can hand you the microphone anytime you can prophesy. He hands you the microphone anytime you can flow in the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
And you flow in the Holy Ghost by what? Fundamentally, what are you going to do when you flow in the Holy Ghost? You are going to deliver the Word of God.
Yeah.
You hear me?
Yeah.
Is that simple or what?
Yeah.
You are going to deliver the Word of God. It's about declaring the things that you know perfectly that is the will of God, that has to do with salvation, with encouraging people, with seeing people built up, and seeing people established and set free. That's what it's all about. Every bit of ministry is all about the altar call. Somebody gets up and ministers and doesn't have an altar call, they don't even know what they're doing. So somebody just never has set in my meetings or anybody else's meetings or they simply sound like a seal. They don't have any concept of following leadership and imitating Jesus. Hallelujah. That got to stop. Why? Self. Pride of life. Your own interest. You're doing it your own way. What you think, what you believe. What I want you to do, and I want you to understand, is that you could be the smartest person in the world and have all of the wisdom of the world. And God says, you are in the category of foolishness.
Yeah. Yeah.
And everybody else is impressed with you, but God's not impressed. The Holy Ghost is going, freaky.
Yeah.
He really believes what he's saying. She really thinks she knows what she's talking about. Honestly. Huh?
Yeah.
But when all of a sudden we say, you know what? I don't know anything as I ought to know it.
Yeah.
I want to rely upon the Holy Ghost to tell me. I don't want to rely upon my abilities, my insight, and my understanding. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
I had Dr. Lau telling me that he was doing a particular type of brain surgery that everyone around him, all of his peers around him, said it couldn't be done. The Lord taught him exactly how to do it. He did it, went in and was successful, and now he set a new course of how to do a particular type of brain surgery. Pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Why? Because he just simply relies upon the Holy Ghost. He's learned how to rely upon the Holy Ghost. He basically was telling me about a particular crazy kind of surgery he was doing on someone's brain. And there's a real sensitive area, and he was finished, and the Lord says, you're not done, not done. He said, I'm done. The Lord said, not done. He said, but done. The Lord said, not done. He turned around, and he went back, and he looked at the x-rays, and he goes, not done. I mean, just learning, it doesn't matter where you're at. I mean, that's in clinical science. Learning how to just completely chart new courses in clinical science. because you just rely upon the Holy Ghost. So we try to just limit these things of the Spirit. You know, here he's helping people who have no faith, don't believe in God, right? Getting them just past whatever it is that they're in, whatever disease state that they're in. But you can, and so God giving them information, helping to elucidate new things, new pathways, new, you know, procedures. Praise God. Now we're great. Well, you can do it whatever you're doing. Amen. What are you doing? What is it that you do? What is it that you do? Do it by the Spirit. Whatever you do, the Father's told us to do it in the realms of faith. Whatsoever is not of faith is. So what is the realms of faith? The realms of faith is moving in the Holy Ghost. It's learning, can I come to a place of decision where I have consecrated myself now to live out the life of heaven and walk in the Holy Ghost and learn a total dependency upon Him? When you begin to lay hold on that, then the contrast between self and you begins to be demarcated. Now all of a sudden those things that have been holding you back are very, very obvious to you, and you begin to despise it. You certainly don't allow it to operate. You certainly don't allow it to impact your decision. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Sikando bodo siti anamaseya. Well, Father, thank you for showing your people here today that simple ministry is the launching pad. A hunger to reach the lost and a hunger to encourage people around them is the launching pad to every manifestation of the gift of the Spirit. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that there won't be a single person in here that will be held back by fear or intimidation. Hallelujah. Boroshenge de mekinda le boshapande, moristando koriste perinashe kina mokalaina, helembando vrevetoya, hambrevetiste. Now, the worst thing you possibly could do is to complicate this. The worst thing you do is complicate it. Hallelujah. Harabastikite de bestakita borodo bostaritia. Must be done, brosavete kalamosatara, with an expectation of it going somewhere in the manifestation of a gift of the Spirit. So will not just be done for any other, for just the sake of doing it. I am going to go after some manifestation of the Holy Ghost. And the first thing that I'm going to go after is feeling a transition to where that I am hooked up with His disposition, which is, if I've got any kind of fear, it's going to transition over to boldness. Huh? If I don't understand, if it's like 5 o'clock in the morning and I've just been woken up and I've been in a deep sleep, right? And now something is required of me. Somebody hands me the face dream and says, talk to so-and-so. Right now they're listening to you in Australia. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to immediately go after talking to them by the Spirit. Yeah. Could I do that 10 years ago? No. I would have had to spend some time. Now I can do it. I go right in the anointing. I go right there. Because I grew. I've grown. I'm matured.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why? I'm giving myself to the growth and the maturity to speak by the Spirit.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this is very simple, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Causes you something.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Probosoko tefitala. So I just want you, what I want you to do is I want you to understand. Here, look, and we're getting ready to do some. We're getting ready to do an exercise here, okay? Okay. But I want you to understand that Charles Finney and others stepped into such a display of the power of God to them, and then ultimately through them, that they could walk into a place of business, they could walk into a town, and people would come become overwhelmed with the power of God and fall out under the anointing. Okay. There is a capacity of the Holy Ghost that is available if we're willing to begin to participate with it. And I want to show you how you begin to participate having this kind of flow of God through you. Okay? You must be willing to participate with it by first and foremost hooking up with what God the Holy Ghost is doing and letting that impact of His presence change you, touch you, affect you. And so one of the things that we want to do here is I just want you to lift your hands towards heaven. And I want you to feel an atmosphere change. And somebody said, well, how do I measure an atmosphere change? Attitude change. You feel something a little different than normal. Hallelujah. Now what I want you to do, so some of you are able to plug right into that, others aren't, okay? Now what I want you to do is I want you to begin to pray in the Holy Ghost now. Pray in the Holy Ghost. I want you to pray in the Holy Ghost until you really begin to feel an impact, an atmosphere change. Now in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough, breakthrough right now. Breakthrough. The hindrance has got to go out of your way. Breakthrough. Breakthrough. Manganda de bembre bebebe. This is it. Mangambra bebebe le bekiri bi eleven ma balaba kiri eleven ma shalaba kiri bi eleven ma malaba kiri eleven ma eleven ma sapra. Mandanda de kiri bi eleve. Mandanda de bebebe kiri bi eleven ma kasusari. Maranda de bebe kiri bi eleven ma bakasa la rana de le diana de masara. Mananda karanaya taranaya shalanana mananana mananaya nakadaya namasaya namahara. Men brende bendona monjeko. Non rama mamma gara vera bigale bile vera mosala bigale bile vera masala bigale bile vera mamma bile bebe. Non breve bebe ki tangele be ki reshi bere mena masasta today. Now, let me just say this. Let me say this. I'm about to fall over, okay? I'm about to get me to stand up, Harley, okay? You with me? So while I'm still standing and sober, let me say a couple of things. Because I still see some people haven't reached past the self. This take you past tired. This take you past sick. This will take you past fearful. This will take you past worry. This will take you past offense, hurt, unforgiveness. This will take you past sadness, sorrow, upset, concern. We got some serious help going on over here. We got some help. And where do we really need? Where do we really need the help? In our attitudes and our emotions. I don't need any more information. You don't really need any more information. Information ain't gonna make you feel better. Oh, somebody come here and read some information to me so I can feel better. You need something inside in the realms of the emotions. In the end, the passions, the attitudes, that's what the Holy Ghost has come to do. You can pray in the Holy Ghost until the peace comes when you're worried or you feel condemned. If you were under harassment, right now, a number of people in the church, in leadership, totally attacked by the satanic realm. Physically attacked. Physically. I mean, Geneva got so physically attacked. It was just crazy. I mean, just crazy. I got hit with the same thing. So that's how I knew it. It's totally spiritual. What we got to understand, though, and everybody has to understand, where's your faith at? Where's your faith at? Is fear set in? Or you feel like you're going to die? For me, it's like there's a place where you can move past that. I have seen the greatest miracles where I was willing to take the greatest risk. Where we were willing to go into the places where they said, if you come, we're going to kill you. Well, you know what? There are various different dimensions of that as well, where we're threatened. Something's threatening. And we say, no, I'm not going to move. Having done all to stand, I'm standing right here. I'm not budging, and I'm not moving. Ruthiana got attacked. Just one thing after another. It was Joshua, just a demonic attack. It was crazy stuff. Crazy stuff. Crazy stuff. Well, what do? We begin to move in a gift of faith that then, hey, how are we doing? Volkswagen? Thank you so much. We begin to move, listen, we begin to move in praying the Holy Ghost until faith arises. And we speak to it. If things don't move, we speak to it again. If things don't move, we speak to it again. If things don't move, we speak to it again. If things don't move, we speak to it again. Now, as you grow and as you mature, you get good at it. In other words, things, instead of maybe before, you had to speak to it, you know, let's just put some numbers on it. 30 times, now you only have to speak to it 3 times. But if you never participate, the more you, put it to you another way, the more you preach, the stronger the preacher, the stronger the anointing to preach. The more you lay hands on the sick, the stronger the anointing lay hands on the sick. The more you minister to people about their soul, the stronger the anointing is to touch their lives. Hallelujah. So what are you going to do? Somebody said, I'm just looking for a place to minister. There's 3 million people in this county. It's like only 35 miles wide and what, about 40 miles long? I mean, it's not that, right? So I want you to let the Spirit of the Lord begin to show you two realms, to begin to pursue, to earnestly desire, and to covet the manifestation of the Holy Ghost in your life. Okay, two realms. Well, really, there's 3 realms. And the first one should be your pursuit of the things of the Holy Ghost, hooking up with spirit knowledge to flow in the Holy Ghost in the way that you interact with Him in that moment of time that you set aside every day. It could touch heaven. Is that spiritual or is it earthly? Is it just normal? Do you feel normal? Some people even feel worse. it's so of them.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Or do you feel supernatural? Is it supernatural? You want that. You want to break through the mundane. And then you want to break through the normal. Hallelujah. Then you and you want to come into Nosekia and Makai and Kaninekia, where you know the presence of the Lord is here.
Hallelujah.
You're interacting with the presence of the Lord. Because as you begin to do that, that is where He's going to give you that capacity to know when to speak the word of knowledge. Downloads from heaven, you just know something about someone, to speak it, to say it, to declare it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Second, the lost. And sometimes the Lord's going to give you a challenge of it being at home. How are you going to be loving? And speak the truth in love to family. Speak the truth in love to people that are around you. People that you don't know, you just make it a practice. It's a practice.
Yeah.
And I'm going to tell you one thing. You know, most people wear the name tags. I'm always reaching to God for something on name tags. Huh? It's a great way to go. Paul? Your name is Paul? You're kidding me, man. You marked for the kingdom of God. Did you know who Paul is in the Bible? Or whatever. I mean, just there's a way. That you move in the Holy Ghost and they are captivated from the first moment that you're speaking. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And to understand how to come to people by the Holy Ghost, because first of all, if you're not sensing the presence of God, if you're not moving in that capacity of the anointing, then there's not going to be any anointing communicated. If you're moving in fear and awkwardness, guess what the people are going to see? That's the beauty of the baptism in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of tongues. We can hallelujah, until we're moved from whatever fear and awkwardness over into boldness and confidence. And now, you know, we don't speak as, you know, just any normal, everyday individual. We say, do you understand the call of God is upon your life? How long are you going to run from God? You ever had the Lord just give you that one? That's a great one. Come walking up to me, how long are you going to run from God? And then they just burst out into tears. How did you know? You just came with the word of the Lord. And most people, that fits. Are you with me? But then the Lord puts it on you strong. But you know what? If you're a if you're being impacted by humanism, and you want to be all sweet and kind and tender to people, I want to just rub them. That is a mess. That is a mess. You want something that's going to lay them out. Are you with me? I want you to get that. Just write that down. Lay them out. Because that's what the Word of God does. It lays them out. Divides. It cuts. It slices. Somebody said to me one time, they said, your Word slices. I said, praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now we're getting effective. It divides. I want to divide. What do I want to do? If they're going to know that God is in, they've encountered God, what's going to happen? The thought and the intent of their heart's got to be revealed. That's what the Word of God is going to do. If you deal with any kind of sorrow or sadness or melancholy or depression, you want to get rid of that. Satan will use that as a defense against flowing in the anointing. Somebody said, how do I deal with it? If it's not the behavior of the Savior, kill it. Kill it. You kill it. Well, how are you going to? You're going to have to kill it by the anointing, though. Going to kill it by the Spirit. And so you just learn how to just say, I'm not yielding my members to that behavior, to that thinking, to that realm. I'm praying the Holy Ghost until that thing's gone. I'm Brahmamans, I say. If I don't feel confident, if I don't feel like I'm 40 foot tall, I'm praying the Holy Ghost until I'm confident. When you got in your car to come here tonight, what was in your thoughts? Now, what was in your thoughts? You think about it. Was it in your thoughts to flow and function and operate in this, in the anointing of the Holy Ghost? As though you yourself were going to be responsible for signs, wonders, and miracles and the demonstration of the Holy Ghost in power? Was for me. We got in the car and immediately Ann and I, everything else gets shut off. Ann and I begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. Actually, we were praying in the Holy Ghost before we got in the car. We're praying in the Holy Ghost. Why? Where it is a privilege that this teacher has given to us to totally yield ourselves to him and hook up with him. But we're not just sitting there praying in the Holy Ghost with no expectation to go anywhere. We're just occupying. You've got to be in expectation to go somewhere. Where are you headed? In terms of the manifestation of the power of God, where are you headed? Let me just give you this clue. When I begin to pray in the Holy Ghost every day at the time that I have set aside specifically to pray, to talk to the Lord, to interact with Father, I pray in the Holy Ghost throughout the day. But when I've set aside a period of time to go over into another realm to be taught of the Lord on another level, to interact with the heavenly. First of all, that is the number one thing. I am going to go into the realm of the heavenly. I am not going to just sit over here and just speak out words into the air. Yeah. I'm praying in the Holy Ghost for atmosphere transfer. Yeah. A transition. I want to be what? Translated. Yeah. I practice translation. I want to move over into a heavenly dimension. It's taking me somewhere. It's not an activity of a means to an end in itself. I am going somewhere. I want there to be an atmosphere change. I want there to be a shift. I am going after a dimension of that realm of heaven that I have encountered and more. Most of you that are sitting in here tonight, you have encountered heaven because someone in this place prayed for you. Sometime you've encountered heaven. You've encountered a dimension of heaven. It may have been expressed as joy. You were just overwhelmed with the peace of the Lord, whatever. Whatever you understand this to be, in terms of the encounter of heaven, whatever you look at it and understand it to be, whether it's joy or peace or overwhelming love, that's a good starting point. It's much more than that. It goes beyond something that can be expressed because you can feel it in every part of your body. It's like a mantle comes on you. It's a glory that overwhelms you. You can feel it in every passion, in every attitude. You're just overwhelmed with this glory. Suddenly, you begin, as it were, to hear the voice of the Lord clearer than any time. Suddenly, that becomes an inspiration of praise. You know He's here. See, it's moving from knowing that He's here because He said He's here, and that's good. But now He's here. I mean, it's like He's here, and there's chill bumps, and there's hair standing up on the back of your neck. You've got to have to go somewhere. You with me?
Yeah.
Because if you're not going somewhere, if you're not going for a specific destination,
yeah,
you're just going to have the same old thing you've always been stuck in.
Yeah.
And it's going to turn into vinegar.
Yeah.
It's going to go sour on you.
Yeah.
Huh. The good thing is here tonight, as I've been laboring this long to get to this point, and I hear in the spirit some of you grabbing a hold of this, and you're going to do it. And I'm going to tell you right now, you will grow. You will grow so radically. You'll just go, wow, I just heard something from heaven. You heard something from heaven because in that place of interaction and building that personal relationship with Him, you began to hear Him speak to you. So now, once you begin to hear Him speak to you, you've got it. I'll tell you right now, once you hear God speak to you, listen, ain't nothing going to stop you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Ain't nothing going to stop you.
Yeah.
And once Father starts speaking to you and you're sitting there holding something that God's giving you, you can see it all over you. Just on you. It's there. Hallelujah. Potakarana masepi hikada. Third is the manifestation of the Spirit, where you're going to go with this relationship in the context of functioning in the church. Where is the first place that you want to be at it? You want an explosion of praise and thanksgiving coming out of your being, because that is your responsibility as a member in the body of Christ, an explosion that's not coming from your head and your throat. It's coming out of your passions and your emotions. You feel it. You feel this. You feel it. That's Holy Ghost. And somebody said, well, I just don't even know how to get there. Start saying, Papa, I want to feel it. I want to feel praise on the inside. I want to feel thanksgiving on the inside. I want to be overwhelmed by Your glory. And if you'll just do these real simple things, you'll see the explosion of the gifts of the Spirit and the spiritual. Because now your heart is set right in the proper place of what you need to be coveting, because it's always in the context of relationship and interaction with Him. Because this is all about knowing the Father. And the Holy Ghost has come to reveal Jesus to us, and Jesus has come to reveal the Father to us. Hallelujah. Condemnation, you're nowhere near Him. Condemnation, you as far away as the night is from the day. No problem, you can bust right through that. So if you deal with condemnation and sorrow and sadness, depression, you as far away from Him as the night is from the day. You locked up in a self realm. Huh? And it's not just a self realm, usually that's an oppression. Satan say, no, I'm not going to allow you. You just begin to take up where you pray in the Holy Ghost to where you're just past that. Wow, I don't feel the depression on me. Wow, I don't feel the condemnation on me. That's your first transition. Praise God. Amen. Now you just found the realm. Now you can keep yourself in that realm if you'd like. That's the realm of love. Knowing that Father loves you and you get to love Him back.
Hallelujah.
If I get a pain in my body, I don't usually say, lay my hands on myself, pain, I command you, go out in the name of Jesus. I don't usually do that. I usually start praying in the Holy Ghost. And sometimes the pain will just go just praying in the Holy Ghost. Then other times, the Lord will cause me and give me spirit knowledge. Woo! Here we are. Can you hear me? He gave me spirit knowledge, prophecy, word of knowledge, word of wisdom. And now I speak something specific by the Spirit. Hallelujah. First time my wife ever experienced divine healing. She called me home from work. I came in. She's there, basically completely laid out, eyes dilated. I looked at her. I wasn't going to get in the cell phone. 911. You know, get to the hospital quickly. I sat down on the couch. I was over it because I'd been praying in the Holy Ghost all the way from work. That's 45 minutes. So I was already in a realm of confidence. I sat down, just sat there on the couch, prayed about 5 minutes, and I was just sitting there looking at her. And she jumped up, touching the ceiling. I'm totally out of pain. I'm totally healed. This is the first time I've ever had divine healing, where it's instantly gone away. Spirit knowledge. I don't have to be, in other words, I'm saying that, I don't have to be privy to spirit knowledge. God, the Holy Ghost, speaking through me and dealing with the thing. So I'm calling water from the rock. It isn't that complicated. You're just obeying what you've heard. It's really complicated if you come up with the idea, I'm going to call water from the rock. Ooh, how are we going to do this? That's complicated. That takes a lot of effort. Thank you, Jesus. So I want you to lift your hands one more time. Now, I want you to see how long it takes you to get drunk, overwhelmed. Okay, anybody has migraine headache, any kind of headache, any kind of sinus headache? Anyone had a sinus headache? Somebody dealing with a headache? Someone's here. You're... Someone here, there's someone here. Okay. Well, just didn't let it go away. Just watch it go away. Did it go away yet? Huh? One more time. Just pray in the Holy Ghost a minute. Watch it go away. Huh? Is it gone? Just do that. You got skills. You got skills. Okay, who in here has never prophesied? One, two, three, four. Lucas never prophesied. Five. Okay. Six, seven, eight. Some of you didn't raise your hand. I've never heard you prophesy. Must have been prophesying at home. Just seven people. Is that all? Eight people. You never prophesied that you know of? You probably have. You probably have. You probably prophesied through prayer. You got so caught away in prayer that you begin to speak things out, and you probably have as well. And you probably have as well. Where all of a sudden you just hit that realm and suddenly you had an inspiration and it was coming out of you, just exploding out of you. That's prophecy. Let me see if I can convince somebody else that they prophesied. Because really, you know, I play around sometimes saying, you know, somebody, all of you should have raised your hand. And really it's more like addressing the issue of those who feel uncertain about it. Well, you know, we just think about when you hit that realm in prayer where all of a sudden there was an explosion of prayer there. It was just a passion, and there was an explosion of prayer, and you know that went somewhere. What happens if you do that more? Guess what? It gets stronger. It gets more powerful. Then that gets to work not only in your own personal life, but and also when you're ministering to the lost, but also even in many respects, just as importantly, in the context of the church. And where is it going to be? I mean, where I think that one of the most blessed places for that to happen is during the worship service. Hallelujah. So the Lord poured out His Spirit upon you to do what? It's just good. You're good. The prophecy is there then. Thank you. Just stand with me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven and just begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Maranda dalalala basikia tere dene meme mena nanesha banona makarala masevreve bevikia rabo basharla. Maride ste breti ste bruna la mandare de beste. Non danda de 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 de. Nana ma de 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 ste breti de te kashe. Non branda dalala de 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 kite de shevre de te kashia. Karama mama mana saya. Kamamre bebe brebe kando la la basebre de. Kamamre bebe mama mando brebe bebe kira la maserre be kara la maserre. Hallelujah. Harama mama nas de kerene. Non onda da da mashiki yarina na mosata da da masabre. Non randa da da bibiki chada da mosambre bebe kina da da maharra. Zezezu tide deste prenenengde de da manjusi. Non prendo un gelacana, non mangiessi, se li dito, non mi sembro, si cana. Hallelujah. Rubebe, rubebe, si kishishi. Hallelujah. 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 Combro, non, 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 de shako. Hey, Chrissy. Chrissy. Chrissy, I want you to come here. Okay. Now, what I want to do is... Chris, you're going to come here and you're going to lay hands on people, okay? So what we're going to do is I want Tori, Alyssa, Annalyn, Zoe, Raquel, Jacqueline, and I want Nadine come. And now what I want you to do is I want you to start down there. I just want you to lay hands on them. Lay hands, start right there. Just lay hands on, just lay hands, just lay your hands on him. Say, in the name of Jesus, feel. Just say that. Just, in the name of Jesus, feel. Touch. Just touch. Now just do the next one. Next one. Next. Now. Now do the next one. And the next. Say, in Jesus' name. Mana. And then the next one. And then the next one. Next one. That's it. Now do the next one. Now do the next one. Now, let me just ask a question. Yeah. You feel an increase in the anointing from where, from when you, before you started over there?
Yes.
Okay. Application. And so that's all you got to do with little guys. Okay? The anointing of the Holy Ghost is on the inside of you. And the more you participate with the release of the anointing through your life, doesn't matter what the results are. You don't even... It doesn't even matter. Stronger the anointing comes.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Dorosane. Rosanne Day. Rosanne Day. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Great confidence. Great peace.
Yes, Lord.
Great certainty. Monday dosheya. Monday dosheya ramange esheto imando ropote. Morina na secto kaya. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Todare de feshik. Totadare vektik. Totadare vektik. Feshik sabretis. Jess and April and Martha and Annika and Sarah, I want you to come. You're gonna come stand here. Come, just stand across here like this. Just come stand right across here. Just stand across here. Make a little bit of room so you don't crash into somebody behind you. Now, Elizabeth, you come here and just start right there and go right. Go down the next row behind me. Next. Now go down there. Oh, no. Now. Now, the one thing is, Elizabeth laid hands on a lot more people than Chrissy has. And there can be a greater release of the anointing. In fact, when we were in Nepal and there wasn't a lot happening, I just had Elizabeth come lay hands on the youth leaders and, you know, things just took off. And so, what I want you to get a hold of is I want you to get a hold of your need to participate. Don't be satisfied with what you have, okay? Press in for more in God because you're zealous. I want greater miracles in my life. You don't sit around wanting greater miracles in your life and don't do nothing. You get after miracles. Hallelujah. We want greater demonstrations of the Holy Ghost in our life. Amen. And so we just participate. It's just really, nothing could be more simple, but it's participating within the context of a viable relationship and interaction with God the Holy Ghost. Continually, daily, it's talking to him because it's ultimately, once again, back to the model of Joshua. He stood before the glory 40 years. You get to go stand before the glory. You can't just have a religious exercise, punch a clock, time clock of hour of prayer, whatever. You've got to go, you've got to press in and say, Lord, I'm just so blessed with the glory that has been revealed in my life, the things that you've done through my life, and I'm just so honored, but I got to have more. See the Moses model? Well, you can't, and God says to him, Moses, he says, you can't have more because you can't see me and live. And Moses is like, he didn't even hear that. It's as though he didn't hear the fact that he's got to die. And if he did, it didn't even matter. I don't care if I got to die. I just want to see more. I got to have more. Now, who in here is feeling average and normal right now? Just kind of feeling average and normal. I want you to come. It's not you. You're feeling average and normal. Not really feeling way over there in the realms of glory. I want you to just come. Because I see you. I know exactly who you are. And it's not you. It's not you. It's not you. I know exactly who you are. See, there you go, okay. But that will produce hunger. Okay, let's come, you can come. Okay, but I'm talking to a couple of people right now, and you're not coming because you're not hungry. You're just not hungry. So you have to deal with why you didn't respond immediately when I said that. In a third world country, I would have been run over. They would have charged me. They would have come running at me. That is why more miracles and signs and wonders happen in third world country. Just that one reason. Because I can say, I can talk, look, you're going to have to go home and you're going to have to go home and deal with this. Because you're as normal as anybody can be normal, standing here right now, and yet you would not respond. Why? Lack of hunger. Or you don't even understand. You don't even understand. Because I know that there are people who sit in church too long and they under false impressions. They have a wrong value system of what it means to function, flow in the anointing. That's for me, that's like deception. It's to keep you from hunger. Because without hunger and without thirsting, you don't get any of this. See, why? Why? It is so sacred to God. He's not lost its sacredness. Everything that belongs to him is so sacred to him. He gives it, it's free, but he's not going to allow anyone to have it that is going to abuse it. And unless you need it more than anything else, this realm of glory, it is just simply not going to flow. Hallelujah. Nambambra this. So just everybody that's up here, just lift your hands towards heaven. Hallelujah. Elizabeth. Elizabeth, you come. Hallelujah. 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 Fire God. Fire God. I'm done this. Grace, why don't you come seek the Lord? We want to get you fully transitioned from a Nazarene to a Pentecostal. Hallelujah. We don't want you to feel normal in the rest of your life. And what we're doing is we're letting some of you just need to cook for a while. If you just stay, that's why I just say sometimes I tell people just stay with your hands lifted up. We're just letting you cook so you can receive. After a while, you stand there in the presence of the Lord and you become more receptive to the Holy Ghost. And it's so important to learn, because that's what happens in your own personal relationship with the Lord, in your living room, wherever you pray. Yeah. The more you give yourself, you cook, as it were. You're giving yourself. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brubada. Brubadea. Having a good time in the kingdom of God. Moshalaya. Mandarene neke. Mandarene neshe. Just cook some more right there. Just cook some more. Jesus. Mang lei, song lei, shang laya, shang ruya, shang rusa, sung risi. Sung roost. Mong JK, in de reche, a morishino. Mandaya. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Fire! Sapana lake. Non blasted. Fix Satara. Malande. Magea. Mandea. Marusa. Marusa. Marusa Mosa. Marusa Maya. Marusa Moya. Marusa Moya. Nai. Marusa Maya. I gotta give you catching instructions, don't I? Manangalea, see. And that's, no, I just, it's fine. Robosta Kedamaya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Robosta Kedamaya Naya. Robosta Kedamaya. Mambrasa, Mananga, Manangalai, Mamandea. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Now, I just pray in Jesus' name that you start having this in your living room. You start having this in your living room, breath in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And hallelujah. Now, the reality of it is, the more you stay in this realm, the deeper you go. Now, If you're going deeper in the things of the Spirit every day, then you step into the meeting and you immediately go there and then beyond. It just keeps going deeper, deeper, higher, higher, longer, longer, broader, broader. Higher, longer, deeper, broader. And Hukare Majeya. Hondo Bohisht. Hondo Be. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, listen, as you do these things, you just go ahead and give yourself, just get lost in the Spirit. That's what you want to do. Get lost in the Holy Ghost. And you're on a destination. Your destination is to go deeper into a place of interacting with Father. You can start hearing Him speak to you. You'll start hearing Him speak to you. You will hear Him speak to you. You will hear Him speak. That is the place of functioning in the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom. That is the place. A prophecy, sometimes the Lord gives me just one phrase, that's it. I speak out that one phrase, and then He gives me another one, and then it just starts a flood. And so I pray in the name of Jesus, everyone who started doing this, if you will participate with God, if you'll do it His way, if you'll respond to Him immediately, don't just drag your feet. Respond to Him immediately. Respond courageously. Respond in a way to where that you're just totally, your heart is totally into this. You're going to become a recipient of that which only Father can give, because He's watching this. He's watching your response. Many people debate, do their responses based upon what they think everybody else is seeing around them. And you shouldn't do that, because that's a full self realm. That's a human realm. You're being motivated by earthly things. But when you respond based upon how Father sees you, it's just between you and Him, you're going to find all those things that He's promised waiting for you at that moment of obedience. So when it's like, when I say, find a bunch of people around you, hug them, tell them that you love them and bless them in Jesus' name. If you just do that and you do it passionately, you're going to be overwhelmed with His love. You're going to participate with His love. You're going to learn how by doing it. Maybe it starts off, you don't really feel much more because you're just like, oh, I'm hugging people, and you just start doing the, you know, person-to-person interface. It will not be long, and it will move beyond that which is natural into the realm of that which is supernatural. And you'll begin to experience a supernatural display of His love through you, on you, to you. This isn't difficult. You must participate. It's not difficult to have. You must participate. And then when you start, as it were, having those breakthroughs where you're really experiencing more in God, you're spoiled forever in the kingdom. You don't have a struggle with earthly issues. It becomes a problem, a burden, something that's grievous to you. And that's why, that's one of the many reasons why you want to do this. And of course for me, and it should be for you as well, just to understand how to move with the Holy Ghost, walk in Him, not only for the things that He wants to supply to us that fills us up, where Satan's stuff has no value to us, but then how we can then go beyond with respect to just the personal interaction with Him and the relationship with Him, which once again, that never reaches a plateau. But we can go beyond our interest and the things that we have need of to be filled with His interest, which is the love and His care and desire that all the world should be saved. Amen. He wants to display His power. God wants us to display His power. It's time you and I put Christ Jesus on display. Amen. And before you can put Him on display, you got to hook up with Him. You have to be first partakers and experience this. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, amen. Thank you, Jesus.